Okay, here we are. Thanks. My name is Paul Pennell. I work at Lynn Benton Community College in Albany, Oregon. If you know where Albany, Oregon is, between Portland and Eugene, kind of closer to Eugene, kind of close to Corvallis, where we have Oregon State University, and about an hour north of Eugene, where University of Oregon is. So we're kind of in a sweet spot to send our awesome students down to those awesome universities. I'm talking today, of course, about can educational technologists really drive change? And by educational technologists, pretty much LMS people, but any kind of technology people that support instructors who support student learning. So in a number of the talks in the big room over there, the theater over there, what was her name, Katie Block, I lost track of how many times this phrase that she gave, that is one of my mantras, but she was had said a number of times, it's not about the technology. Well, I'm a technology person. Most, if not all of us, are here. Well, it is about the technology, isn't it? No, it really isn't, actually. It's fun and is engaging and pure fun, really, back to that word, as I find the technology that I deal with, that I help instructors at my college deal with, really, it isn't, for them at least, about the technology. It's about doing anything they can to contribute to their students' learning and retention and success, essentially. Yeah, through all these cool technologies and processes, but the focus isn't on the tech, it's on the students. So I have sat through so many workshops and sessions here at this conference and others where I'm just constantly amazed at what we can do with the technology to contribute to that learning and to expand beyond the time and space limitations of the classroom, of course, and also to facilitate how students can contribute to other students' learning also. So where we're going with this, let me get my stuff organized here. Real change comes from which of these? Okay, the first one's a joke. But real change comes from all of these. Now, me personally, what I've experienced from working at Oregon State University and my college, Lynn Benton Community College, is, especially at my college, it's the middle one that really drives the change. Whether it should be or shouldn't be, is or isn't, the reality at a lot of institutions that I'm aware of and that I've worked at is if faculty want it or don't want it, that's pretty much the way the college is going to go. So how can we, as educational technologists, if not drive that change, strongly influence that change, strongly encourage and influence faculty to bend to our will? What am I looking for here? So what I'm getting at is yeah, the reality of faculty driving change primarily, but I believe that we can strongly influence that along the way. I think the bottom line of what I'm talking about right now is on this slide here, and it really relates to building intentional relationships with the people that we serve. Now, in the classroom, one of the strongest components of a good, solid teaching effort by the instructor, it's the instructor who builds solid relationships with their students. Because you learn better from someone you trust and that you can relate to, you have something in common with. So the instructor who lays down that commonality as soon as they can with their students, those students are going to succeed really well. And so on our end, even though we may or may not have a teaching role or an instruction role, we kind of actually do with the instructors that we serve. We have to show them quite a bit sometimes, if not the whole thing, on how to use the technologies that we're wielding. So if we build honest, good relationships intentionally and find areas of commonality with them, they're going to be much more relaxed coming back to us, especially in third and fourth time when they need to learn something new, need a refresher on something. So my biggest strength right now is when I can find myself standing nicely on a good balance between being in, you see the circles with the guys' feet down here. I have one foot in IT and one foot in with the educators or the trainers, the people that deliver the learning in my institution. If I can have that balance, if I can speak both languages, if I can be the interface quite often between the hardcore IT people that don't really deal directly with students and faculty, and also speak the other language back and forth, that balance is where I've been most successful. And I feel like I've been able to drive some change. As low on the totem pole as I am there, I've driven some change at my institution. One of the biggest ways I've done that, and I've seen that done with others, is the ed tech people that backed up everything they offer, every tech, every technology they offer, with support, training, and learning resources. As in, you can't just offer a new technology with, hey, everybody, we have this really cool technology. Here is your username. Here's your starter password. Good luck. You've got to have more of that. It really helps to have some support resources dedicated before you even announce this new technology. Have some training, whether in a live setting and or online, at least some kind of learning resources, if not fully customized for your institution as far as how you want to use the tech, at least something that the company that produced the tech has put together for you. Something more than just, again, here's your credentials, have a nice day. Because that is how one technology was brought out at my college a while back. The only thing that I saw coming out for Microsoft 365 two or three years ago was, hey, you'll be happy to know we're rolling out Microsoft 365. Your username is your, I believe it's our, I don't even use it. Your username is your, I think it's your email address, and your starter password is so-and-so. Have good luck and go forth and do great things. And very little to none, nothing in regard to that backup training and support, and here's how you use it. Here's a great way to use it. And to me, an apparent, what's the word I'm looking for? If instructors get wind of any kind of technology, a lot of them are going to say, I wonder if I can use that in the classroom. And so sure enough, I get people coming into my office, asking how they can use Microsoft 365, and I don't really use it. We officially support and adopt Google Apps for Ed. And Google Apps for Ed at my institution started off kind of as a rogue, well, not kind of, it was a rogue software that I started just as a pilot, just to see how we could do with providing content in our Moodle system in a way that won't require students to have Microsoft Word, Excel, PowerPoint. So I offered it to a few instructors as a test to see if it was even worth bringing up, to ask IT if we can bring it in officially. And so primarily in regard to Google Calendar and Google Drive. So what happened was it gained some grassroots interest, especially in regard to Google Drive, Google Docs. And in about 3 years, it was officially adopted because it was proven to be, at the point of the game, strong enough and viable enough for both employees and students. Now, I went around it kind of backwards, but I found out later on if I had asked permission before even offering as a pilot, I would have been told no. So I did the right thing, I did the wrong thing, whichever way it happened. We have gained a lot of ground in that regard for both instructors, for both students and all the employees. So on a note about that word I used earlier, I'm kind of one of them, the rogue people, the rogue instructors that want to use their own LMS, a different LMS. The ed tech people who can have that relationship still with the rogue people who don't want anything to do with the ed tech people, you want to find a balance between telling them they can't use the technology of their choice and using whatever they want. If you've got to find that balance in there, because that last statement in there, you can't completely discourage or disallow rogue technologies, because the next greatest thing that might seriously make a contribution to your student success might be just around the corner. And if it isn't on your radar, that doesn't mean that it shouldn't be on someone else's. So is it making sense to try to find some balance between cutting off the rogue and welcoming them? Somewhere in the middle is what I found has worked the best. So back to that bottom line, as much as we have fun, and I have fun playing these technologies, the ones I'm involved in, but really the bottom line is how can that technology and the way we use that technology honestly contribute to my primary client, who is the instructor, the student, and my secondary instructor, who is my primary client is the student, and my secondary client, of course, is the instructor who works for the student, too. So having that relationship chain is really what helps things out as far as being able to, for them to know they can come to us with anything they need technology-wise, rather than feel like we're having this big separation, this big gulf between us. And that's why I believe that the best way that ed tech people can drive change and contribute to change, real good change, is by through these intentional relationships. Does that make sense also? Questions, comments, disagreements, agreements? It isn't about the technology. Thanks. And I must have done something right because the learners aren't leaving. Look at that. Excellent.